Assalamu alaikum, greetings, and welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. We are streaming live. And if you'd like to participate in today's conversation, you can give us a call at 773-434-6625. Before I introduce our guests, I would like to remind you, as always, to please follow us on our social media platforms, which include Facebook and Twitter. And please go to our YouTube page and click the subscribe button so you can be notified whenever we post a show. I'm very excited about today's guest. It proves to be a very informative show. I am joined by two special guests representing the Chicago Police Department. I am joined by Director of Community Policing, Brother Glenn Brooks. Welcome to the show.
Evening, sir. Thank you very much.
Also, we have the Deputy Chief of Recruitment and Retention, Ms. Magdalena Burnless. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
I'm so glad to have you all on the show. We've had, of course, relationship with the CPD before y'all have come and spoken to the community. And, you know, it's so necessary now, I think, because by all accounts, all the media that we see is always negative or a different kind of perspective. And so I wanted to talk about some of the proactive things that you all are doing in the community. And so I know in today's show, we'll get to talk about your recruitment efforts. We're going to talk about the gun turn-in programs and a lot of other things that maybe the public doesn't really get to know about. And so, but before we get into that, I'll give each of you an opportunity to introduce yourselves. I'll start with you, Mr. Brooks. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
You know, I started with the department going on 19 years ago, but I really started before that. And I really started as just a guy living in a neighborhood who, at the time, the mother of my son did not want to come to the house because she did not want to get off at the train station. So she was scared to death. Yes. And I could not have her not come over. Right. So I joined the local CAPS meeting. I went in, I sat on one of those metal chairs, and we tried to figure a way to deal with that train station in that particular block. And that's how I really got started here. Okay. And then I was lucky enough to get a phone call from then the director, Vance Henry, asked me, well, did I want to come on board? And little did I know the ride he was giving me. Yes, so this has been an experience, and I can't tell you how great it is to serve the community and really try to make a difference out here.
That is great. And Ms. Bullens, I know that you had a recent promotion, but tell a little bit about yourself.
So I have almost 24 years on the job. Okay. Actually, I was given a new assignment, which is recruitment and retention. I've been in this actual assignment for 2 weeks. All right. Prior to that, I was in the Bureau of Detectives for 2 years. With many assignments prior to that. Okay. But I am grateful to be here. I am a girl from Humble Park. Okay. And I grew up in Humble Park with my father and my family. I was given the opportunity to take the test in 1993. Right. Got on the job in 1998. So I waited 5 years to get on the job. Okay. And I'm going to tell you, I wouldn't trade it for the world.
Well, you know what, and I'm glad to hear you say that. I think that, you know, so often we don't really get to talk directly to officers to see what things are like. And since both of you work with the community and recruitment, let's talk about the recruiting efforts, why it's so important. And I'll open it up to both of you, either one of you, like that.
It's very important because we're seeing a different change coming through. Mm-hmm. It used to be the tradition of the police department. When you think of a tradition, you think about the typical, what you see on TV, SWAT, K-9, Marine unit, helicopters, big tough guys running after the bad guy. Mm-hmm. That all has changed. Mm-hmm. What we have now is a different side of policing, which is like non-traditional. We have individuals that are needed that have educational background. They were teachers. They have some kind of technology background. We have individuals that are a project manager. So we have a little bit of everything. With the recruiting efforts, we are now tapping into those individuals that have a talent because we're looking for the talent to come on CPD. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we need the officers to fight crime, but we also need that talent to keep us going.
Okay. And so, Brooks, how does that, you know, when you talk about director of community policing, and if anything, especially in the last 2 years, we realize and recognize that, as you were stating, policing is more than just arresting people. There's the service part that's been magnified huge. And so with your background as director of community policing, how this, and I don't know if we could call it a culture shift, or but it's an increased focus on the service aspect. How does that play into this?
So it plays in a large factor. So the deputy was talking about how this was a traditional job. It used to be your father got on, then the son got on, then the brother got on, and it was, you know, very much kind of the blue blood thing that you see on TV. And here's where the changes come. We want to make sure that we're reaching out to every block and every community. I can't tell you how much when we go to a community meeting that people want to make sure that police officers are representing their community, that know their community, that have lived the lives that they're familiar with. And when we say we're going out to each one of those communities, this is the opportunity to make the difference, to make sure the police department reflects Chicago, reflects the value of Chicago, of our neighborhoods. And let me just say this. When I say this is a unique opportunity, the deputy talking about taking 5 years to get on a job, that used to be the norm, if not longer. If someone takes a test this year, there is a high probability, guess what? They are getting on this year, meaning they're starting this year. And I don't mean December, I mean January.
Right.
But, you know, that is a sea change. It's also a sea change in the process. Before, you used to just go take the test and you were waiting for a letter to come in the mail. There is now, you know, the deputy, she's not singing her praises here. She has a team of people who reach out and help you through this process. Because it's not like going to McDonald's and filling out an application and getting a job the next day. What it really is a process. You're going to go through several steps, but there's someone there to help walk you through to it. There's someone there to help promote you and get you ready for the physical test, to let you know, hey, this is what's expected in a background check. This is what's expected in a psychological check, and tell you what's coming next and et cetera. And all that is a process which he has a team of people to help you get through.
From a recruitment standpoint, what are some of the qualifications that you all look for in a potential officer?
We're looking for individuals that want to be part of the community, help the community. Sometimes individuals don't know they actually have that until they get on the job. When they start exploring, growing, they start in interactions with the community, that kind of, you kind of blossom, and you kind of see what direction you want to go into. We know those individuals are out there. So an individual who wants to, you know, come on the force, grow as a person, because you really do. I have 24 years on a job, and being out in the community, I have had a chance to understand the community, understand the cultures in the city of Chicago, and that's a huge. But not only that, somebody who wants to make it a career. Too often what we're seeing is we have individuals come on, do a couple years, and they leave. Make a career. There's so much to offer here. We have tuition reimbursement for those who want to continue their education when they come out of the Chicago Police Department, which is huge because we're one of the larger departments that do this. Not too many police departments offer this. We do. But not only that, when you get inside the police department, there is so much you can do. And we are termed, like the director said, we have a team of individuals that a program has been created that has been never done here in the city of Chicago. We now guide an individual from the very first contact that the recruiters have with this individual all the way through the process. When they take the test, we're building mentoring program where now they can interact. We're getting the social media up. We're live. We have tested this for the last couple of weeks since I've had this position. And we had 10,000 people just going through live and streaming live at the events and saying, you know, ask your questions. They're asking questions. This is something that these kids now do. Social media is huge. Twitter, Instagram is huge. So we're now tapping into that to kind of, you know, let them know, we understand you. Mm-hmm. You know, come aboard and we will guide you, you know, to the police department.
Well, let me ask this, and I, you know, with that support, because I know that regardless of the recruitment efforts, it's particularly in the Black community, and I'm sure similar numbers in the Latino community, but I know in the Black community, the distrust, the perception, it's still going to be hard to get people to apply, recruit, and that trust, because, you know, even in that support, if you're guiding them along the way, how do you, what support or what would you tell the young Black potential candidate that's on the fence and think that they may not fit in with the culture of the PD or may not be accepted?
I would ask them to give us a chance. Mm-hmm. I would really talk to whoever it is and kind of let them kind of start coming into the force, hang with us, talk with us, bring them to more officers so they can see what this really is about. There's many individuals that had a bad experience somehow or some way, but we're here to let them know that that's not who we are, that's not what we do. And I think they really have to be open to accepting this and let us, you know what, let us at least, you know, step into their world so that way we could kind of do this together. Mm-hmm. Too often we hear, you know what, we don't like the police, you know what, they did this, they did that. But if they come in and they experience this firsthand, I believe 100% they will change their minds.
And I think it's also important that, so before here, I stopped by and I got a little shoe shine. I went over to Boss on 75th. And there was a guy in there and he was telling me about the experience, you know, a bad traffic stop that he had. And I can tell you, as he told me this story, the pain, the fear, it was like it happened today. I mean, and he was charged, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I said, okay, let me just ask you a quick question, just so I get a better understanding. Can you tell me when this happened? He's like, yeah, man, it happened in like 2000. And here's the thing that we remember, that the pain and those experiences was traumatic and it shapes people's perspective of it. But also know this, that everybody here today is making sure that we have opportunities so those situations don't happen, that there are officers here that have those experiences and know how to speak with people, to give them the respect that they're so due. And we can only do that if we get new officers from the neighborhoods into the department. It's hugely important that the deputy grew up in humble apart, because you guess what? She can tell you about the stories.
Right.
She can tell you about the different people in the park and what, you know the unique right. thing. You know, if we ask her what school she's gonna go, she's not gonna give us a college. Yeah. She's gonna tell us exactly which high school.
Yeah.
And she can tell. That is important. That is something that we need as Chicago. Only way we're going to do that and ensure it happens is if we apply to this job. And I want to talk about applying to this job because this really isn't a job.
Right.
This is a career. When they first offered this, I told them, no, I don't want that job. My mother corrected me. Does it come with a pension? I was like, yeah. She's like, boy, let me explain something to you. That is a career. And a pension is something that you don't just walk away from. That is something that helps you security, that builds generational wealth. I can tell you, there's been some generation wealth that's been built, not because it's this great high-paying job, because it's consistency, it's security, and it makes a difference to not only you, but your family.
You know, when what would you say, in particular in the last 2 years, has impacted you the most in terms of community policing and recruiting? Because I'll tell you, you know, I see the restraint. I see, you know, some of the things that happen, and you know, there are other instances, but particularly in this culture now, how impactful has that been?
I think for me, mm-hmm. I could speak of an experience that I had as a commander. Mm-hmm. When I was promoted to commander, I was the commander of the 4th District, mm-hmm. Southeast Side. Yeah. So I'm a huge faith-based person. I'm a huge community. And one story that just stands out with that, and I will never forget it because this speaks to volumes of what you can do when you have the community on your side. My faith base and I just got to the district, we connected, but there was an individual, a teenager who was murdered on a certain block in the 4th district. From there, we knew that maybe problems were going to start arising from this. The very next day, I had just left the district going home, when then on that particular block where the individual lived, it just turned ugly. Mm-hmm. Everybody just started going back and forth with the police. So I came back. Now, mind you, it took me 45 minutes to get back to the community. When I got there, tensions were very high between the police and the community. So I arrived on scene. As soon as I arrived on scene, I had an individual, I had a few individuals mm-hmm. say, no, we know her. We know her. She's okay. We could trust her. From there, when I walked on scene, I immediately had to take the police officers off the block and calm everybody down. And when I said to the community, to the faith-based individuals, I said, I need your help. And they helped me. They helped me calm the tension down on the block. They helped me regain the structure. And everybody did exactly what I told them to do. Why? Because at that point, I already established something with the community and the faith base, which was huge. You know you have the community and you know they trust you when something like that happens. I will never forget that because that was so powerful. To this day, myself and the faith base for the 4th District, mm-hmm. we are very connected, very connected. But that is the kind of connection that we are talking about as we go out there. That connection that I built as a commander is the connection that I want my recruiters to have because it's very important. It's very important to, we're going to touch every single community in Chicago because we want to see the police officers represented mm-hmm. by those communities. It's so important.
Well said. Yes, how many, I know there's recruiting efforts right now. I mean, are you all have a certain goal to build up a number of recruits or what are we looking at?
What we're looking for is the, right now we're gonna be opening up the application process which starts for 2022. So we're going to hopefully have a whole year of testing that we'll be able to provide online testing, also with some in-person testing. Mm-hmm. But we are looking to bring in as many as we can bring, thousands, if possible, by the end of the year. Okay. So this is going to be a monthly, a weekly, a daily, going out to the communities every day. This will be nonstop. Mm-hmm. We're going to be out there so we could touch those individuals and then bring them into the, you know, to take the testing somehow, some way. And some individuals do need a little bit of guidance. And that's what we're gonna be there for, is to guide them. Mm-hmm. Phone numbers, they can call us, email, mm-hmm. Facebook, whatever it is, we're going to be there for that.
What's the minimum age?
It's going to be, to get on the job, is 21. Okay. But you can apply when you're 18, but you cannot get on the job until you're 21.
Is there a limit on the other side of that? I want to say too old, but I mean
39 is still the max age. 39.
I couldn't think of the polite way to say
yeah.
that. Okay.
39.
Okay, good. You know, and I believe this is so important because we would want to see officers that reflect the community. I think to help establish that trust, that rapport. But I know that there's so much to overcome in doing that. Are there any things that we could speak to that a prospective, let's say, high school student might want to know, that would disqualify you, that we would tell them to kind of stay away from? I mean, is...
I think the best advice that we could give is just be honest.
Yeah.
Be honest and mm-hmm. definitely try to get your credits for school, for college. Mm-hmm. It is so important. If you do not have all of them, do not feel that you cannot get on this job. Please reach out to us so we can guide you. There are many programs that we have at this point, and that's the thing about this recruitment team. Now, keep in mind, I have 24 years on a job. We had none of this when I came on the job. I just went cold and took the test and figured it out. There was no one calling me saying, hey, how are you doing? You know, can I help you? Now these individuals do have that foundation. So they need to say, you know, they need to think, never think that I can't do this. Never think that, oh, you know what, I can't because I have this, I have that. Talk to a recruiter. Let them guide you and give you the facts before you decide you can't do something.
All right, well said. I want to go to the line with a caller. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question.
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Jameer.
Alaikum salam, sister.
And greetings to both of your guests.
Thank you.
I have a couple of questions. It's interesting when they're talking about the recruiting aspect of it's very difficult to get our people engaged because most of them are criminalized, don't qualify. I'm in the 8th district, specifically BA 32, and I have attended the BEAT meetings. Now there are, we've got Jaffa Smith, they may recognize Officer Tracy over there. And what I often notice is that many of the officers in that area do not look like me or you, and that is a problem. They try and they live as far outside of that area as humanly possible. So when they come to the area, it's hard for them to, in my opinion, feel a certain way about the community in which they do not live. I also noticed that there should be a shelf life to being an officer. They see a lot, they experience a lot. And to have them on the street for so long increases your rate of suicide. Also, my final comment, if they can answer this question. When they are trying to recruit these guys, and you're saying that you're going to start texting online, how do you stop them from cheating? I know a little bit about the testing process that goes on there, and the biggest problem is the cheating. And that's how will you stop that even online? And those are my questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. And to recap, speaking about in particular the 8th district, that many of the people who are officers working in that district are not from the community, and therefore it would be hard for them to exhibit any care and compassion in a community that they're not really associated with. She also spoke about the shelf life of an officer as far as the support and all that, their experience, and of course, the last thing, how can I forget the last one? I'm sorry.
The cheating,
yeah, on online testing, right. So those are her appointments if you want to respond. So.
I could take the last question for okay. The cheating. Mm-hmm. The process to become a police officer doesn't focus around the first written test. Mm-hmm. That is just to guide and kind of balance you on your reading and comprehension. Mm-hmm. So there's really nothing to cheat about. It just wants to see if you understand and you comprehend what's going on. Now, that moves you along through a whole process. You have psychological testing, medical testing. You have a bunch of other kind of buckets that you have to walk through. You have an interview. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. You have an interview. So there are certain facts that, you know, you can get disqualified. So let's say somebody does cheat on a comprehension test. They're not going to cheat their way out of a polygraph. So there is a lot of other steps that they have to go through. But the first very written test, that's why it's given online, it's a comprehension. Can you read? Do you understand what's being put in front of you? Mm-hmm. Here's a scenario. Can you answer the questions? So basically, that's what it is.
Okay.
So let's talk about the second one, the shelf life. And that really kind of dovetail into officer wellness. Mm-hmm. And the caller is absolutely right that we have to be concerned with our officers, not only physical, mental, and spiritual thing. So there's a couple things that are going on. Mm-hmm. So we really have expanded our clinicians, meaning somebody for somebody to talk to help decompress. We've expanded what we call our EAP, our Employee Assistance Program. We've expanded our peer-to-peer. And this is something that the superintendent and all command staff take very, very seriously. This year, for the very first time, when I think I started and the deputy, we used to have about 3 to 4 clinicians for the entire department. Mm-hmm. Starting in January, we will have a clinician for every single district that will be assigned mm-hmm. to, so officers can find somebody if they need to talk to. We've taken multiple steps to de-stigmatize the fact that, you know, hey, you need to go talk to someone. Listen, after the last couple years, and, you know, I will admit that I'm one of the people who will say, I'm okay, until you're not.
Right.
And at that point, it gets a little late. So, you know, even I will go and talk to someone to help decompress that. And we have to balance that out. And you're absolutely right. And I want to make sure we get to the first question, mm-hmm. which was, help me.
About the officers, really at the crust of the recruitment, that the officers do not yeah. reflect the makeup of the community, and therefore it's hard for them to exhibit that care and compassion for that. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I think that's why we have a recruitment and retention team. I think that's why we're out here. And I think that's why we're asking the audience, please, we need help recruiting. This is a time when you need to call your nephew, your cousin, your brother, and say, don't go by what you think. Go ahead, take the test, and apply, and we will see if we can work you through the process. Now, there's no guarantee. There's certain things that, because of the nature of the job, it might take you out. But there's a lot of things that we can work through. And I kind of just want to touch on this, one of the kind of old wise tales, kind of, and that's a psychological test mm-hmm. that is designed to knock out people of color. Mm-hmm. So there's a couple things there. The test has been looked at a couple times now to make sure that is not the case. But there's a step in furtherance. If you go through the test and you feel that the test has not accurately, there's an appeal process. There was no appeal process before. Okay. You know, so there's a process that you can, if you don't agree with it, that you can appeal it and so forth, then it goes through HR and et cetera. These are steps that weren't taken to ensure that we get not only the best qualified, but the most reflective applicants to the department.
Let me ask, let me go to the line for caller. We have another caller first. But caller, go ahead with your question.
Hey, this is Brother Gator. How you doing, sir?
Fine. How are you, sir?
Hey, man.
Hey, man.
I got a question. When they make mention of the psycho and all those different things, when it comes to
Gator, you went out. Are you still there? Gator, we'll call back then. Okay. Hopefully he'll call back. Let me ask, do you all, I know that the city, there's certain minority numbers as far as, well, that's usually with contractor numbers, but is there a certain threshold that you all, a goal that you all have in the police department as far as minority hires and officers?
That would be discriminatory.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's be kind of clear here.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The outreach is broad and wide mm-hmm. to ensure that we're reaching every mm-hmm. single neighborhood.
Right. Okay.
There isn't a number that we have to hire right. this many. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
What we have to do is ensure that we're reaching out to the communities, that the opportunity is being presented. Mm-hmm. You know, there's arguments, was this opportunity fairly presented to everybody mm-hmm. 50 years ago? Right. I don't know, but I know today, we are making sure every neighborhood has an opportunity to apply.
Great, okay, I think we have Gator back on the line. Gator, go ahead with the question.
I'm sorry for dropping out.
That's okay.
What I was saying in the community concern, especially the African American community concern, it's like Jim Crow. How many marbles is in the jar when it comes to black applicants for the fire department or the police department? Okay, when we see how crazy these white officers are acting, one has to wonder, did they take a psychological evaluation? When it comes to the African Americans, they ask the question, what gang is in your community? But you didn't ask the white officers those type of questions. What they feel about the author of white, and what do they feel about the Ku Klux Klan? You know, those are the concerns that a lot of us have, and they don't seem to be balanced. Okay, I agree. I would be the first to say that African Americans need to apply to become police officers and firemen. But for somehow, whoever's doing the scoring of the test or whoever's doing the evaluation, it ain't the same type of thing when they come to white and black. We keep saying the fire department, they uncles, they nephews, all of them get on there. But it's hard when it comes to African Americans, being the fire department or the police department. So who going to make sure that the evaluations are the same for African Americans and whites? Do they ask them what gangs are in their community? Do they ask them is any Ku Klux Klan members a part of their family? Do they ask them if they're part of the ultra-right? And how do they feel about the January 6th invasion of the Capitol?
All right. Thank you, Gator, for those questions, comments, little response. Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
So on the psychological test, mm-hmm. it's standardized. Mm-hmm. There's one test that everybody gets. Mm-hmm. I think Gator's point highlight the added step of the appeal process in the hiring. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you, I know for a fact that there were candidates who appealed their psychological. There was candidates that appealed other different steps in the process and have been hired and have won their appeals.
Okay.
When I say that is a sea change, mm-hmm. as the deputy was telling you when she got hired, is they came in, if you were missing the piece of paper they were asking, they bounced you back to the back of the line.
Okay.
That's not happening now. You have a right to appeal and to go through this process and have a fair appeal.
Okay.
So I get it, and I think everyone at the city recognize that, okay, how can we make this process even more transparent, even fairer?
Right.
How can we give people an opportunity to get on the job in a most fair, and also at the same time ensure that we have qualified candidates? And I kind of want to put that out there. We're going to make sure that we hire people of integrity. Mm-hmm. The challenge has been in the past, people with integrity never had the opportunity. We're making sure you have the opportunity.
Okay. We're going to take a break, but when we come back, I want to talk about the military background, because it seemed like for a while a lot of people with a military experience were hired. However, the combative style of the military versus policing in the community, it often doesn't fit. And we want to talk about that kind of impact. Or are there any additional tests or questions for people with military background who've served in combat, just to make sure, just to see how that translates to the police force? Okay, we'll do that. All right, brothers and sisters, we're going to take a break, and we're going to come back with on the other side with more interesting conversation.
This portion of the Muneer Muhammad Show is brought to you by East Lake Management, innovative solutions for building communities of the future today.
Searching for a restaurant that serves delicious home-cooked meals at an affordable price like your grandmother used to make? Well, the search is over. Stop by McArthur's, the new talk of Chicago. We offer a warm atmosphere with friendly service and excellent meals ranging from carryout, dine-in, or catering for your special events. McArthur's is open 7 days per week from 11 a.m. until 9 p.m. Come visit us at
5412
West Madison Street or call us at 773-261-2316.
You are watching The Muneer Muhammad Show, a production of CRO. Please take time to join us at CRO, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. CRO is the National Archive of the Nation of Islam and houses one of the largest collections of historical audio, video, and print documentation on the total black experience. CRO is located at 2435 West 71st Street, the corner of 71st and CRO Lane. We are open 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Our number, 773-925-1600. We look forward to seeing you at CRO.
Eat and Run Chicken and Fish has the only chicken you can reheat and eat. It's good as mothers and better than the others. It is the chicken even mothers love. We've been serving the community for over 30 years. We cook with 100% vegetable oil and are open 7 days a week, including holidays. We're located at 87th and Hermitage. Contact us at 773-429-1812 for your takeout order or let us provide all your catering needs. For the best chicken of your life, it's Eat and Run.
Assalamu alaikum, and we are back continuing our conversation with two fine representatives of the Chicago Police Department. And again, this is a live call-in show. If you have a question or a comment, you can give us a call at 773-434-6625. And it's a break. We're just talking about some of the officers that served in combat, you know, and with military experience. Is there any extra test or support? You know, how does that translate into policing? Because I know a lot of former military and police forces across the country. However, you know, serving in a military combat side is very different from community policing.
Yes. Mm-hmm. As far as I know, the mm-hmm. same testing that mm-hmm. a regular person without the military, mm-hmm. they get the equal testing. Mm-hmm. So they don't get a different testing or a psychological or different tests to go through, batches of tests if you're in the military versus mm-hmm. not being in the military. Okay. So it is equal all mm-hmm. the way through. But there is support for those individuals who are military combat officers. Mm-hmm. There is, I guess, we have the wellness program that, again, we're having 11 clinicians attend to the police officers of the department. Mm-hmm. So we do have a foundation that's being built for those individuals that seek help, or maybe, you know, we have another individual officer says, you know what, I think this officer needs a little bit of help. So mm-hmm. we have something in place for that.
Okay. And
can I just add yes. one other thing?
Yes, sir.
So there's one aspect of getting hired. Now let's remember the other aspect. You have to go to the academy. In the mm-hmm. academy, we teach you the way that you're expected to police, the respect you're expected to give within the academy. That process is another 900 plus hours. Mm-hmm. Now, when you're done with that, you then become what we call, you go through your probationary period, where you're going to be evaluated by a number of mm-hmm. what we call field training officers. Mm-hmm. Okay, you're going to go through all those different processes before you are a full-fledged police officer. So all those processes are designed to make sure that we give you the instructions that are necessary to become a police officer. And as a former military guy, mm-hmm. one thing that you definitely learn in the military mm-hmm. is how to follow orders. And it is something which, this is why the police department is appealing to former military, okay. because there is a structure.
Okay.
All right.
Got it. Let me ask this. With the community policing, we talk about that. Historically, you know, it were more beat officers that had relationships in the community might walk. I see more people, you know, on bikes in certain areas now and in certain neighborhoods trying to get back to that. But as far as, is there a strategy as far as the beat officers and trying to build more rapport with the community, business owners, things like that?
Absolutely. So let's kind of talk about that. Mm-hmm. So obviously, Chicago had the CAPS program, which at one point we were up here. Yes. We were the worldwide leaders. Mm-hmm. And then through budget cuts, other things, it kind of went down here. Other priorities kind of took over. Mm-hmm. Over the last 5 years, and particularly with the consent decree, and I can't stress this enough, because in a consent decree, it really stresses community policing as the very first chapter. Okay. That's where we start at, right?
All right.
So we've made substantial investments back in community policing. Community policing had been reduced to an office with just three people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. For more than half my districts, I didn't have organizers. Mm-hmm. In the last 3 years, we've taken the number of people in community policing and increased that. The average district has between 6 to 7, some districts have 9 officers in their community policing. Mm-hmm. Addition to that, we've added the what we call the Neighborhood Policing Initiative, which has these officers called District Coordination Officers, which are officers that are dedicated to one specific geographical area within a district, and they are really concentrating and focusing on problem solving. Mm-hmm. Dealing with whether it's that liquor store, whether it's that house, or whether it's those people who just seem to hang out on this corner, mm-hmm. all right, to dealing with that and trying to work with community members to develop strategies which mitigate okay. the problem. All right. Yeah. All those things is our recommitment of it. And then if you add in, so one of the things that we were talking about, how do you make sure the officers interact in a more positive way with the community? That's what we call, every time there's an expectation that officers do it, and they must get what we call a PCI, positive community interaction, right? Okay. And all it is this acknowledgement of, hey, I need to get out and I need to interact in a positive way outside of a traditional law enforcement. And I can tell you this year alone, we've done several hundred thousand of those. Actually, we're right around 500,000 for this year, okay. all right? Now, that is nowhere near the superintendent's expectation. He wants us north of 1 million.
Right.
All right. Okay. But what it has done, it is changing the culture to say, hey, you got to get out here and have a positive interaction. You need to go to the community and engage the community. One of the things that I hate when people say is that we do all these events. I don't want to do an event. I want an engagement. I want you to go out and build a relationship with a community member, whether it's getting them information, whether it's us sitting down talking about policy, mm-hmm. whether it's us working together to build up the community, or whether it's us working to deal with a problem in the community. Somewhere in that array of engagements, you should be reaching out to the community. And we're spending a lot of energy getting there. We still got a long ways to go.
Okay.
But we definitely have a pathway to get there.
Great, great. I want to go to the line. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question.
Hi, assalamu alaikum, and good evening to your guests. Mm-hmm. The taxpayers of Chicago have to pay for the lawsuits against the police department when they commit a murder, mistakes that they make. Shouldn't there be something set in place within the Chicago Police Department for the policemen to be accountable for the mistakes that they are doing instead of the citizen of Chicago having to always pay out the lawsuits that they are responsible for? Thank you.
Yes. So I let me tell you what we have done. And I think it's important to acknowledge that. Mm-hmm. So up until the consent decree, when there were any payouts and et cetera, okay. you know, we might address it through some training. We might address it. There might have been some discipline attached to it.
Right.
But essentially, there was going to be a payout. What has happened is that we have taken on a risk manager, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And that risk manager looks at all the circumstances around those lawsuits and see what the department has to do to change to mitigate it. I'll give you an example of it. When we looked at our pursuit policy, we looked at it also with our risk manager in determining what is the policy that allows us to apprehend bad people mm-hmm. and what will allow us to mitigate those risks of an unfortunate accident yeah. or increase mm-hmm. an increased risk, what can we do to mitigate it? And that's how that policy was rewritten.
Right.
You'll look at it, we have a unit that looks at our body cams to look for issues that we can do better in training, mm-hmm. so that we can help mitigate these risks and the payouts of the task, the taxpayers. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think everybody's looking at that,
yep.
and I think we're coming up with ways to mitigate it. Mm-hmm. But we hear the point, and there's been steps taken.
Well said. Good. All right, caller, go ahead with your question.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
Good evening to your distinguished guest.
Evening.
Yeah, y'all are really good representatives of, or I should say, good face of the police. But most police, I venture to think, are not like you two. I think you two have the job of coming out and putting the best face forward. And you're doing a good job of it. But I'm an old school organizer of the CAPS program going back maybe 25 years. And what I would like to know is, what do you want of the community? Because it seems like CAPS has been co-opted by the police, where it used to be a police and community partnership along with city services. Now, it just seems like the police tell you what the deal is, how many people get killed, and give you some more crime stats. But it's like there's nothing that the community should be is tasked with doing. See, when I was an organizer, we had police and community trainers. They would go out into the community and train the community as to what their role is in CAPS. And that created smarter people and was able to allow people to tell the police and work with the police as to how they wanted their community policed. Now, I don't know what's going on there. And I went to one, and I'm like, wow, you know, where's the community? So, you know, I'm a little bit, you know, I mean, then I'm not trying to be negative. But the police, to me, in Hollywood, has been propagandized over my lifetime. It's like every channel that I stop on, there's a different kind of cop on. And they got names like Beretta, Magnum, you know, and Rifleman. You know what I mean? I just don't feel police.
We get it, brother.
I actually agree with you. When I first started, guess what? I was a beat facilitator. Then I was a DAC chair. And we had trainings which we would work with the police officer. The police officer, when I was in 24, I was beat 24, 23. And I was just a guy living in the neighborhood. The sergeant came over and we sat on my porch and we came up with different strategies. And we went to different trainings. You know, that is one of the things that we really wanted to start in 2020. And I can't tell you how much I am sick of COVID, because we cannot get people together. We can't get people together in training. We're just now really getting back to it this summer, but there's still those concerns out there. We are looking at doing a number of trainings with the community. And when I say trainings, it's not just the police department. We're looking for community-based organizations to partner with us, to give us the training so we can work together. We have been able to do it and some limited cases. So right now, I can tell you, we have all of our community policing officers. I have community-based organizations coming and doing training with them. I can tell you, we just finished the strategic planning process. I hope you got to go to your district, but we sit down with community members in every single district, and we talk about, how do you want your district police? What are the top priorities, not only for crime, but for engaging the community? Every single district just finished that. We did it in October, November. We have a few others finishing this month to have exactly what you're saying, that conversation. We are going to continue to do better with this, but it is absolutely, you're 100% right. This is not about what the police are going to do to solve the challenges that we're facing. It's about what we're going to do together to make sure that we have the communities that we want.
You know, I think we have one more caller. Caller, go ahead, make a quick question, please. Go ahead.
Yeah, how you doing? My name is Mark Quinn McDonald. How you doing? Something like Brother Jamil. I just wanted to make a quick comment and salute everyone that's there on the panel, including yourself. Something I wanted to... I'm sorry?
Oh, no, sir. Go ahead, brother.
Oh, yes, sir. So something I wanted to point out real quick, because I know a lot of people may have frustrations with the Chicago Police Department, but as you know, Brother Jamil, by interviewing Brother FX, who's the co-founder to our organization, Watch Guard Chicago, we've had a unique opportunity to be out in the street to somewhat get a small feel of what the police department goes through. And I can tell you it's not easy. Yes, there are issues within the department. Yes, are those issues, do they need to be fixed? Yes. But there are those same issues inside our own community in itself. A lot of us don't even want to fix our households, but yet we'll come at the police department. So this isn't necessarily me defending the police department, but this is me adding the balance. We have to fix our households, ourselves individually. We have to deal with our traumas and have to find ways of helping our police and our city to heal from their traumas as well. Everything that you see out here in the community at this moment is trauma-based. Yes. It is trauma-based. All the gun violence that we see in this city and in this community is not necessarily gun violence. I mean, it's gun violence, but there's precursors, such as nutritional violence, educational violence, and economic violence.
Yes, sir.
So these things all have to be addressed. And if we don't address those things and start with ourselves individually, then our households, our blocks, and our community and neighborhood, then we can't argue and complain about anything. The police, I can tell you right now, from being out patrolling in this neighborhood of Bronzeville, Kenwood, and Hyde Park, it is very difficult to see everything, be everywhere, and try to help everybody. Yes. And they are under a high level of stress. Most people that are complaining have never even been on the job or have done anything close to what they have to go through. They are under stress every single day. They are either under stress from what they have to, what's going on systemically in the department, and they're under stress when it comes to the community, not just because their life is in danger, but because they know how people feel about them. It's hard to perform sometimes under that. So once again, we have to have a realistic and balanced perspective when it comes to the police and ourselves. And once we do that and have that honest conversation with ourselves, and it's based around actual healing, we will then be able to start seeing the change that we need to see inside of our neighborhood, our communities, and especially, more importantly, our homes.
Thank you.
So that's all I wanted to share. Good job, everybody, and have a blessed and be safe out there.
Thank you, brother. You too. Well said. And as we close up, and you know, to brother's point, I wish we had more time to build on. I know we can, but I know that there are some initiatives or things you've been a part of with mitigating as far as food deserts, preventive violence and violence prevention and things like that. But I know in our last few minutes, I want to talk about the gun give back program, because I know there's an event coming up soon. But talk about the importance of that and the success.
So the gun turn-in. Mm-hmm. The gun turn-in. So here's something that's very unique about guns. Mm-hmm. Guns is something that if a gun was made yesterday, last week, or 10 years ago, it can still kill you. It can still hurt you. It can still cause trauma. And guns are one of those things. How do you get rid of that unwanted, unused, that gun that somebody has passed away and left to you? How do you get rid of it? The gun turn-in is one of the unique things where, guess what? We can work together. You can come in this Saturday. We're going to be on 119th at Christ Universal from 10 to 2. We will give you $100, no questions asked. I don't care where it came from. I don't care where it's been. I care that we now take that gun off of the street so it can never hurt another person. $100, no question asked, 10 to 2 at Christ Universal. There are way too many guns, and it is affecting all of us. My own mother, when my stepfather passed, didn't know how to get rid of her gun that she had down, that was up in the closet, that old 45, where I don't know where he got it from, but when she needed to get rid of the gun, we found a way. This is the way for you to get rid of that gun that you have in the house. I don't care if you find that gun underneath somebody's bed, in the back of the closet, in somebody's car. I don't care where it comes from. I care that we get it off the street and you get $100, no question asked, and I don't care how many guns you bring me.
Tell us, and I know just in a minute, the Don't Kill a Dream, Save a Life program that you're doing. Why is that so important?
That's really the brand name of the gun turn-in. Okay. I think another important point we want to talk is about the tip line.
Yes.
And I think they have the graphics of it. Mm-hmm. So what we've done this year is we've established a fund. I don't care when the murder happened. You can call this line. It's completely anonymous. You give the information. You can get up to $15,000 for information leading to the conviction. Now, let me tell you how kind of it works. If you give information and it leads to an arrest, you get, I believe it's $5,000. If that person is indicted, I think you get another $2,000.
Well, they'll see it up there, brother. Thank you so much. Right. We have to bring you all again back on again soon, okay?
Thank you very much.
Brothers, I hope you enjoyed this evening's broadcast. On behalf of the Chicago Police Department, particularly our brother Glenn Brooks and Ms. Bullness here, Chief Deputy Bullness, and the Crow Television production team, I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad. Thank you for viewing. I leave you with the greetings of peace and prosperity. Assalamu alaikum.